Western blotting, also called immunoblotting, is a widely used technique to monitor protein expression in a cell or tissue extract based upon antibody binding to a specific protein of interest. Antibodies used in Western blotting can be specific to total protein or to a post-translational modification of a protein, such as sites of phosphorylation, acetylation, methylation, or ubiquitination.
At Cell Signaling Technology, we perform Western blots daily to validate our new and existing antibodies. Here, we provide a complete protocol for the technique based upon a decade of our experience. We also provide a list of commonly used reagents that are used by CST scientists and work optimally with our antibodies. Using additional directions found on your data sheet, you can simply replicate what we are doing here and get the expected results in the shortest amount of time. We will also discuss the critical steps in Western blotting and how protocol changes can affect the final outcome of your blot.
Before you begin, you should have a number of solutions on hand. Directions to prepare these solutions can be found on the protocol page of our website. These reagents include 1xPBS prepared from 20x stock, 1xSDS sample buffer prepared using either CST blue loading buffer pack or red loading buffer pack. See the sample preparation section for alternate use of cell lysis buffer or RIPA buffer, transfer buffer, 1xTBST prepared from 10xTBST stock, blocking buffer prepared from non-fat dry milk, bovine serum albumin or BSA, primary antibody dilution buffer containing either 5% BSA or 5% non-fat dry milk as indicated on the product datasheet, signal fire ECL reagent, pre-stained protein marker, and a blotting membrane.
This protocol has been optimized for nitrocellulose membranes. PVDF membranes may also be used. However, we find they may increase background.
To harvest the cells, aspirate the cell culture media and wash the cells with 1xPBS. Then, aspirate the PBS. Next, lyse the cells by adding 1xSDS sample buffer. Add 100 microliters of buffer per well to a 6-well plate, or add 500 microliters to a 10-centimeter plate. Then, immediately scrape the cells off the plate and transfer the extract to a microcentrifuge tube. Keep the cell extract tube on ice. Alternatively, the samples can be lysed using 1x cell lysis buffer, or they can be lysed using 1x RIPA buffer. Both buffers contain the necessary phosphatase and protease inhibitors for common protein assay methods. Now, sonicate the cell extract for 10 to 15 seconds to complete cell lysis and to shear nuclear chromatin. This also reduces the sample's viscosity and is especially important for detection of membrane-bound and nuclear proteins. If SDS sample buffer was used, take a 20 microliter aliquot of the sample, heat it to 95 or 100 degrees Celsius for 5 minutes, and then cool on ice. If cell lysis buffer or RIPA buffer was used, remove a 20 microliter aliquot of the cell extract, add red or blue loading buffer pack to a final concentration of 1x, and then heat the sample to 95 degrees Celsius for 5 minutes and cool on ice. Now, microcentrifuge the cooled samples for 5 minutes at room temperature. Next, load the centrifuged sample onto a square SDS page 4-20% gradient gel. Alongside the sample, load 10 microliters of the pre-stained markers and 10 microliters of biotinylated protein ladder to determine molecular weights. Run the gel using SDS running buffer. When the gel is done, set up a transfer cassette in transfer buffer as follows: wet sponge, filter paper, gel, nitrocellulose or PVDF membrane, another filter paper, and sponge. Make sure to remove any air bubbles. Close the cassette and insert in your transfer apparatus in the appropriate direction. Then, electrotransfer under cooling conditions at 70 volts for 1.5 to 3 hours. The measurements for this section are for a 100 cm square membrane. For differently sized membranes, adjust the volumes accordingly. After transfer, wash the nitrocellulose membrane with 25 milliliters of TBST for 5 minutes at room temperature. To block the membrane, incubate it in 25 milliliters of blocking buffer for 1 hour at room temperature. And after the hour, wash the membrane for 5 minutes in 15 milliliters of 1x TBST. Now, dilute the primary antibody using 10 milliliters of recommended dilution buffer, which has been uniquely determined for each CST antibody. Then, incubate the membrane in the diluted antibody with gentle agitation overnight at 4 degrees Celsius. The next day, wash the membrane 3 times for 5 minutes per wash with 15 milliliters of TBST. After the washes, dilute the species-appropriate HRP-conjugated secondary antibody at 1 to 2,000 in 10 milliliters of blocking buffer. Antibiotin HRP-linked antibody can also be added to the 10 milliliters of blocking buffer to detect the biotinylated protein markers. Incubate the membrane in the diluted secondary antibody solution with gentle agitation for 1 hour at room temperature on an orbital shaker. After the incubation, wash the membrane 3 times with 15 milliliters of TBST for 5 minutes per wash, then proceed with the protein detection. For protein detection, prepare the SignalFire ECL reagent by mixing one part of 2x reagent A with one part of 2x reagent B. Incubate the membrane in 10 milliliters of SignalFire ECL reagent with gentle agitation for 1 minute at room temperature. Next, drain the membrane of excess developing solution, but do not let it dry out. Then, wrap the membrane in plastic wrap while it is still wet and expose it to X-ray film in a darkroom. An initial 10-second exposure should indicate the proper exposure time. Cell signaling technology antibodies are validated using our recommended Western blotting protocol, which has been developed and optimized by CST scientists. Minor changes to the protocol can dramatically affect the results. For example, skipping the sonication step during sample preparation can result in a greatly decreased signal, especially when detecting chromatin-associated and membrane-bound proteins. Primary antibodies can be diluted in a TBST buffer containing either 5% BSA or 5% milk. The optimal dilution buffer has been predetermined for each antibody and is included on the product datasheet. Using a dilution buffer other than the recommended dilution buffer may result in a less than optimal signal. The primary antibody incubation period can vary greatly depending upon which protocol a researcher is using. CST recommends incubating the primary antibody overnight at 4 degrees Celsius for all CST antibodies. Some Western protocols recommend a 2-hour incubation at room temperature, which we have found leads to a weaker or no signal. Another area where Western blot protocols can vary is with the wash and dilution buffers. CST recommends using tris-buffered saline with 0.1% tween 20 for antibody dilution buffers and wash steps. By comparison, using phosphate-buffered saline with tween, or PBST, in place of TBST, weakens the signals for all the antibodies shown. CST recommends wet transfer for 2 hours followed by a 1-hour blocking and overnight primary antibody incubation at 4 degrees Celsius. Alternate protocols that dramatically shorten transfer and incubation times may substantially weaken the signal.
In closing, we hope this video is a helpful resource for performing Western blots using CST antibodies in your own lab. Please also view our second video, Western Blot Troubleshooting Guide, where we discuss common issues with Western blotting and how to troubleshoot.
Cell signaling technology prides itself in providing you with exceptional customer service and support. Since all of our antibodies are produced in-house, the same scientists who develop and assay these reagents are available as technical resources for our customers. These scientists can be contacted directly and will personally provide technical assistance to you, our customer.